before we get started, what we have in front of us right here?
My Funk Harbor rum, Jamaican authentic rum. No additives, no preservatives, baby.
Wow, Jermaine, front, right, dead center. Obviously, not anything new to you fighting on these big cards, but I guess how's this fight week just been differently? Because obviously you're supposed to fight in October, got pushed back a bit. A lot of fans and fighters seem to be on your side in surprise that you're on the prelims. So I just guess how's life been and how's camp been leading up to this?
Camp's been great, outside of the injury, of course, that we were supposed to fight at Salt Lake City. Unfortunate freak accident in training. That was crappy because we were just peaking at the right time, and I was super excited to fight in Salt Lake. But other than that, things have been good, healthy, ready to go, no excuses, which I like. Hopefully it's the same thing for Mozar, no excuses, may the best man win.
Mozar gets, you know, a lot of fans call him boring. You know, Dana White famously said his last fight against Arnold Allen was one of the worst fights he's seen. When you break him down and you're watching tape on him, is he a boring fighter or is he just so good that he can make, you know, his opponents look bad in there?
I mean, I can appreciate a technical fight. So I wouldn't really consider him boring. I think Dana saying that fight with Arnold Allen was boring was kind of a stretch. I think most people would agree with that. I think it's probably more of his dislike for Mozar. I think he might dislike him more than me. So that's a good thing. 8 fights, no finishes, all decisions. I at least got a couple finishes in there, especially in the beginning of my career. When the competition isn't as tough, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to separate yourself from the competition, and I've been able to do that. Fighting the best guys is not easy to finish the best guys in the world, but I look to do that on Saturday night against Mozar.
He's posted some stuff on Instagram, like using the hashtag Aljo Stay Healthy. He posted that video of him with the birthday cake for you. He said that you DM'd him something in Russian or at one point or something like that. So is this personal between you two, or are you guys just kind of having a friendly rivalry and you're building the fight?
I think it was like Dagestan language, but I think they told me it means like, what's up, bro? Something like that. What's happening? That was really it. And then he said, stay healthy. No bad blood on my end. I know he was a little butthurt about the steroid allegation, but I'm like, dude, I don't know. You don't hear that from my circle of friends or anyone I've ever trained with. There's got to be a reason why people are actually bringing that up. And again, I had never seen him do anything. I don't know. He's never popped for anything. So I don't know where those people who told me that got that from, but maybe he should check who he's talking to, because clearly someone said something and maybe he did something. I don't know. But either way, we're going to fight. It is what it is. It's going to be a great fight. Grappler's delight. Maybe end up like a striking affair, which would be fun for everybody. I think it's a win-win for both of our careers in terms of people calling either one of us boring and title implications on the line.
Well, he said something similar in the sense that, you know, this matchup against you specifically, he goes, I can show them something that will be exciting in there. So are you viewing the same way when Mavzar steps across from you?
Yeah, so we're on the same page then, because that was exactly what I said. I said, I have a willing dance partner. You know, if I take him down, he's not going to just hold on a clamp down the position to prevent damage, prevent me from passing. He's going to actually have to do something. And people do that in jiu-jitsu too. If you ever trained, you have a role with people that are not so great. If they know how to just defend, they could kill the position and not let a lot of action happen. So it takes two to tango. And I think both of us being willing to grapple, I'm hoping I get to show some more of my stand-up in this fight. I really do. Maybe this is like a Kamaru Usman versus Kobe Covington.
And then, you know, I asked Mavzar this question. I'll ask you the same thing. You know, do you feel like this fight's kind of flying under the radar in the division? Because, you know, the second Ilya beat Max, they brought in Volkanovski. They're talking about Diego Lopez obviously fighting for an interim title. You're a former champion. Mavzar hasn't lost yet. And it doesn't seem like anyone's kind of including this fight in the number one contender fights. Mavzar's comment was, you know, Volkanovski's a legend, but he's done. So is Holloway. It's time for fresh blood. Do you have that same sentiment, and do you just kind of feel like this fight's flying under the radar?
I agree with Mosa or not. It kind of reminds me of 135 when it was always TJ, Cruz, and Faber. TJ, Cruz, and Faber. It's like, guys, there's other bantamweights that can fight. You just got to help us build up the stars. And I think 145 is at that point now. Ilya came over and has done a tremendous job talking his talk and actually backing it up, which is a very hard thing to do against two guys like that. Even his fight with Josh Emmett, he's got a ton of style points. It's just, I think it's an exciting time for the featherweight division. I'm excited to be a part of it now towards the end of my career. And hopefully I can stick around long enough to realize UFC gold.
I know you've talked about it a lot, but, you know, fighting on the prelims, Bryce Mitchell is in here, and he goes, I don't know why I'm on the main card above Aljamain. He's a former champion. Anthony Smith said, you know, if I can get paid the same and get to watch the rest of the fights after mine, then sign me up. So I just, where are you at now, now that it's settled, you know you're fighting on the prelims? Is it still a sore subject, or do you now kind of understand what's happening?
I don't really understand what's happening because I haven't spoke to the UFC about it, but nothing changes. I get paid the same money. It doesn't matter where your placement is on the card. Your contract is your contract. The one thing I will say, there's more people watching on the prelims generally. The only thing for me is that the crowd in Vegas, which kind of sucks, everyone's out partying, they had fancy dinners, they're doing all kinds of weird stuff because what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, and then they come to the main card. So maybe the arena won't be as packed. That's the only bummer about it. But other than that, it's lit either way. Gonna party, hang out afterwards with my friends and family, drink some Funk Harbor, and celebrate a W.
Where can we get this in stores?
We got this. This will be in Lee's, the Age Room, age 2 to 5 years, 3 different Jamaican distilleries at Lee's discount liquor stores. So people can get it out here in Vegas right now, well, tomorrow. So I'm excited about this. Thank you for Lee's for helping me bring the brand into Nevada. And you can get it online at funkharborrum.shop.
But you can't go to any stores in New York or anything yet?
Not right now. I've been here mostly, so I own the company. So it's not like I put my name on something and just pay me something for representing. I'm actually the brand ambassador. I do everything. So I can only be in so many places at once, and I also have to focus on my main career, which is fighting. This is more of a side hustle, something I've always been passionate about. And it actually tastes great. Don't take my word for it. Go ahead and try it.
And then just last one for me, unrelated to your fight. Can I get your thoughts on the co-main event between Shavkat and Ian Garry?
That's going to be a good one, man. I think it could be a real technical fight. Or if it gets to a point where Ian is maybe outpointing Shavkat, that he might just, I don't want to say go crazy, but just go after him and try to get the finish. I just feel like they're very close. But between the fights I've watched, I feel Ian Garry's a little less hittable, and it seems like he does a better job of controlling the distance, and I think that could be problematic, especially when Shavkat fought Wonderboy. It seemed like he was having some trouble closing the gap, but when he was able to take him down, he was eventually able to get the finish in, I think, round 2. So it should be a very good matchup, 2 undefeated guys. Wish it was for the interim title, but it's going to be a great fight either way.
Just one question for you. You mentioned already a little bit about the placement on the card. Was it nice to see fans getting behind you for once, like backing you up?
Yeah, it was nice. Thankfully, they've gotten behind me a couple of times since my move up. It's like as soon as I lost the belt, they started coming around again. I remember when I beat Sanhagen, it was Pedro Munhoz and then Sanhagen. You know, I was like the uncrowned people's champ, and then I got kneed in the head, and somehow I became the villain overnight. But it is what it is. It's nice to see, but I'm happy either way. As long as I get to compete, they're not docking me on fight pay because of my placement on the card, so it's all good. The main thing is I got my friends and family out here, and it's going to be a good night.
Thank you.
Aljamain over here. Chris Weidman got added to the card. Obviously, you know, teammates coming out of Cerro Longo and everything in New York. Have you gotten to run into him, and how is it having that synergy, having your teammate or ex-teammate on the card?
It was good to see Chris. We're still really good friends. We haven't played each other in chess in a little bit, so I got to challenge him. I don't want to hurt his morale going into fight week, so I might play him after we both win. But I remember we both fought in Boston, and that was kind of shitty because we both came up short. And it would be nice to turn it around this weekend. If not, we're never fighting on the same card again. So we make sure that was known. I'm not one for superstitions or anything like that, but it's nice to have teammates that you're fighting with and people that you're familiar with. Just makes it more fun to be in the back room, calm each other down, get each other excited, pumped up, and ready to go.
Do you have the better head-to-head record against him in chess?
I think we're about 500, but I've won the last few.
Thank you.
Aljo, over 15 years ago, John Jones sparked your interest in MMA when he invited you to train at the Bomb Squad gym. Now you two have a combined 20 wins in UFC title fights. You got 4 of them. What message do you have to the versions of you and John from 15 years ago?
What was that last part?
What message do you have for the versions of you and John from 15 years ago?
I guess the message I would give my young self is just keep going. Great things are bound to happen, and just trust the process and keep being you, and good things will happen.
Aljamain right here. Now that you've been at 145 for a couple fights now, how does it compare? Is it to bantamweight? Is it just a night and day difference?
It's a night and day difference for sure, this part of fight camp, but it's still a hard weight cut. I think my body fat percentage sits between 5 and 6% on a regular basis, so cutting down, having to dehydrate, it's just never easy because I'm a super lean guy. But it is what it is. It's much nicer. I feel more powerful at this weight class. I feel stronger. I feel my energy levels are higher, and my output is a little bit, I can keep my output a little bit longer than I did at 35. Once I hit that weight, 135 on the scale, it's like part of me was left on the scale, and the last few fights, I didn't really get to show up and do what I know I was capable of in the training room.
There's a lot of moving parts in the featherweight division, obviously with Topuria, Volkanovski, Lopez. Is there a path, in your opinion, if you win on Saturday, to a title shot in your next fight?
The path is dominate Mosar. I dominate Mosar. I think I take care of a lot of issues outside of that, things that I can't really control. I can only control my performance. The UFC is going to say who they want to fight for the belt next, and hopefully it gives me a shot if I go out there and do a great job and win.
Aljo, you sort of made a light of it earlier that they dislike Mosar more than you. Is there a part of you that thinks, like, if I go out and dominate this guy and get him out of the rankings for them, they'll kind of owe me one afterwards and maybe push me up a little bit?
Yeah, I think they might cut me a check in the back room. Say, thank you, Hitman. Thank you.
Aljo, just went to your left real quick. We know some of your goals as a funk master, such as wanting to become champ at 145. But what does Aljo, the man outside the cage, still have kind of on his bucket list? I know you have the Funk Harbor rum. Congratulations on that. But what are some other things, maybe whether it's another endeavor or just something in life you want to check off one day?
Another endeavor. You know, I always admired Antonina Shevchenko because she could fly a plane. And I was kind of like, when I was a champ, I thought I was going to win the defend the belt a couple more times and then go up and then fight for another belt so this way I could keep the championship pay. I was like, I'm going to buy a little mini plane. I'm going to learn how to fly. And my fiance was like, no, you're not. But those are some other life goals. I would like to get a little bit better at golf. Justin Gaethje's a beast. Daniel Cormier, I hear he cheats, but I hear he's a beast too. Yeah, just other things outside of fighting. Life's good right now. And I got no stress, no pressure with anything. It's just go out there, do my best. And I think those are the most fearful guys, the guys who can fight freely because they have no stress on their shoulders. Thanks, guys.